Hey, y'all, what's up? I'm Chris.
I'm Ben from Blackstone Cherry.
And you're watching Loud TV. Crank it. Man, you know, we just finished up the Carnival Madness tour, and I think the biggest accomplishment in all the reviews I read were the fact that even in an arena with 8,000 people, it felt like an intimate show. And I attribute that, man, and I said it on stage when we were doing those shows, to the respect and the love between the crowd and us. You know, like, we do a song called The Rambler every night that's been on acoustic guitar and me singing. And the whole crowd falls like completely silent and listens to the song. And it's just so beautiful to see that amount of love and respect between each other. And I don't know, man, you know, with everything that happened last November at the Bataclan, to be able to come to Paris and play a show and have a group of people able to celebrate good people and not bad people doing horrible, horrible things, to come and just release and let go and kind of let that all go to the back of your mind for a minute and just have a good time was beautiful, right?
It was incredible.
Incredible. Dude, I think the coolest thing for our band is the fact that, like, you'll see a grandpa, a dad, and a grandson, or a grandma, a daughter, and a granddaughter, or the combination. And you see them all at the show, and everybody's smiling and having a good time. That's amazing to me, to see fucking three generations of people having a good time listening to one band's music, you know, because it's hard to do. And I think that's been one of the calling cards of our band and one of the saving graces is even though we don't get played on radio that much, and you know, we still are able to draw a crowd of a mixed group of people, and it's not just one age group or one religion or one race, it's just one big eclectic group of people having a good time every night. Well, they left us.
It was a mutual thing. Yeah. I think we both just got to a point where we wanted different things out of each other. So we just split ways, and we've recently signed with Mascot, who are very
awesome
and knowledgeable and very passionate about the bands they work with. And that was something we were wanting, and they have a lot of new ideas. And, you know, they're working us hard, but, you know, it's worth it because, you know, in the end, they want the best for us. So we appreciate them, you know, putting us up on a pedestal like they have been so far.
I think they just have a higher regard for rock and roll in general. I mean, like, Roadrunner was great, and then Warner bought out the remaining, like, they bought 75% of Roadrunner. And then when they bought out the remaining 25%, we knew, like, I literally said on the bus, this will be our last record of a Roadrunner. I just knew it would, because it became, instead of being a homegrown, let's build a band label, it became corporate, like, you know, all your big, huge labels. And, like, the thing we like about Mascot, man, is Ed knows what he's doing. Ed is a music fan before he's a record label executive. And, like, to go sit down and have dinner with a guy that owns a record label before you ever sign with him, and have the guy who's the owner go, well, what kind of guitar amps and guitars do you and Ben play? That, like, was a holy shit moment for us, because we're like, you mean you don't care what clothes we wear? You just want to know what guitars we play? This is, like, incredible. But to have Ed and the whole team, like, be rock and roll fans. Like, the thing about Mascot is they've taken bands that were never really radio bands. You know, Joe Bonamassa is an incredible artist who's not a radio guy. Black Label Society, Government Mule with Warren Haynes, you know what I mean? Like Sonny Landry, Beth Hart, all these incredible artists that are very musical but have never had the radio exposure. To have a label that can take their careers and just make them much bigger than they are I think that at the end of the day is why we decided to sign with them and felt like we had the best possibility of expanding our career with them.
We all still live there, and we recorded our first album there. We recorded our very first recordings there before our first album was out.
We still live within 2 or 3 miles from my mom and dad.
This being our fifth album with a new label, and we got to self-produce the album on our own. It just made sense for us to come back and work with the same engineer that we did the first album with, and use the same kind of equipment we did on the first album, and just kind of bring it full circle, so to speak. And all the extra musicians, all the horns, the strings, the background vocals that we had come in for special parts, they were all from Kentucky.
We haven't mentioned the whole day that the 16 channels of the board that our engineer have were out of the original Abbey Road EMI board. Yeah. Like, he has the only one that's stamped EMI, Abbey Road, has all the stampings, the Chandler Limited. He got one of the first 16 channels out of that board, that Dark Side of the Maroon. Dark Side of the Moon, and Abbey Road to record it on.
Pretty amazing equipment.
That's everything we're recording goes through, so it's like...
It's pretty, it's got some vibe.
Just a touch.
Yeah.
Smidge.
So it just made sense. You know, we've gone to Los Angeles, and we've gone to Nashville, which isn't far from us at all, but, it just made sense to do it. We wanted to do it there again to rekindle that old atmosphere, and it was great.
There's something awesome about sleeping in your own bed every night after recording a record. You know, getting up, eating breakfast at your house, and then going to the studio. It's pretty kick-ace. But it's not about that. It's about paying homage to what we're proud of. I mean, like, you know, you're from Paris, right? Are you from here? Okay, but you're from France and centrally located around Paris. You're obviously proud.
Not from Paris.
You're proud of who you are and where you're from. It's the same thing with us, man. Like, Kentucky made us who we are, and that house on the cover of the album made us the band we are.
Yeah.
You know, The heritage and the culture of where we're from is what made us who we are, and we're extremely proud of that. And, like, you know, it's funny, man. We're from a town of 1,500 people, which is the capacity of most venues in this town. But the one thing we always look forward to more than anything is at the end of the night when the show's over with, we're ready to go home, man. We want to go see our families and drive around back home where, you know, you go to the gas station, everybody knows your name. It's such a simple way of life, and just a good old boy mentality of just be cool to everybody. That's what we've always loved and who we've always been and what we can't wait to get back to. It's so awesome. I mean, man, to be, most bands when they depart from our record label, they're scared to death. Us, we were like relieved, a little bit scared, but mainly relieved. Because we knew we could finally make the music we wanted to make for the last 10 years. You know, you've always got a producers going. And, dude, we work with some great producers. Bob Merlett did an amazing job with our second record. Howard Benson with the third. For what each record was, the producers did incredible jobs. But for us, we just wanted to make the music that the four of us wanted to make this time. And the fifth album around, and 10 years later, it was kind of time for us just to go, you know what, fuck it, we're going to do what we want to do. And it's all on us this time. So if people don't like it, we're the ones that have to answer. But this is the most honest and truest representation of our music that you've ever heard. You know, we've got horns on the record, you know. Hell, we all love Get a Grip.
Yeah.
You got to have horns on the record.
Aerosmith incorporated those, you know, brass stuff in their music. And it just...
But Permanent Vacation and Get a Grip was where they did that, right?
Yeah, and Pump.
Yeah.
So it just... We wanted to do that, you know. And so we were finally relieved that we could have the opportunity to do it. It's our live, you know.
Well, we literally took our live amps into the studio. Sorry, yeah. I interrupted you.
No, it's fine. I mean, what we use in the studio is what we use live, because we want that sound to, you know, transpose when we play the songs live. We don't want to use something we can't recreate.
Les Pauls, 6550s, your McLean's.
Yeah.
And I had the PRS guitars, PRS amps. I mean, it's literally what we use live. We took it into the studio. We put a SM57 and some kind of super kick-ass ribbon mic on it, ran it through Neve channel strips into that EMI board and straight into Pro Tools.
Just like we did when we first started.
Yeah, I mean, dude, it's literally the exact same microphones we used on the first album. We We just got better amps now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, or more options. But, like, dude, it was so cool to go in and do a record that nobody was looking over your shoulder and going, well, you can't do this or you can't do that or you have to do it this way. We literally went in and did the entire record in 20 days. We recorded 18 songs in 20 days.
Yep.
That's
it was,
like...
It was fast. We worked pretty fast in the studio.
If we were running marathons, we'd have won.
Yeah.
There's something about that Southern groove that drives people crazy. Pantera.
Yeah.
Okay, Pantera is one of my favorite metal bands, you know? And you look at the groove they had, that's what set them aside from Metallica and all these great bands, and Megadeth, Dave, whatever. But you look at all these great bands, and Pantera had this undeniable groove. You know, like Lamb of God is one of my favorite metal bands. They're good friends of ours. Our guitar tech worked for them, worked for us for a while, and then back with them. But they're one of those bands, they've got that groove like a Southern metal band, man. You know what I mean? Like, what's that other band we like so much? Maylene and the Sons of Disaster.
Yeah.
Like, all these Southern bands, not to say that we're better than anybody, but damn, we got the groove.
South has, man, a little bit of a...
It's a greasy groove.
Yeah.
I like, that's a great term, greasy groove.
Yeah.
We have the greasy groove, but it's so awesome, man.
It covers a lot of stuff. Personal stories, things that we've experienced together, fun songs, you know. Road songs about being on the road, you know.
Soul machine.
We write from what we feel, what we believe in, you know. And ultimately that's what people is gonna relate to, you know. So we won't sing about anything that we haven't either experienced with someone. Or watch somebody, you know, close to us go through. That's the kind of music that is really going to resonate with everybody. So,
you got to mean it when you sing it, or it doesn't. Like, from speaking from a singer's perspective, you have to mean what you're singing, or it doesn't come across. You know, even though the Rambler was written, the majority of the song was written by a friend of ours. Like, I know what he's talking about when he was singing those words to us. So that's why it means something to me to sing that song. You know what I mean? Like, it's...
It has to hit a chord.
Yeah, it's got to mean something to me. We go out on tour. We're doing a few shows of Volbeat in April. And then we're going out with our good old friends, Buck Cherry, which we haven't toured with since 2006.
Yeah.
We're going out with them in May. And then we're doing some festivals in America, and then we're going to Australia in June, back to the UK for the Ramblin' Man Fair in July, and then the rest of the year will be a lot of U.S. touring. It's going to be awesome. We're excited to get back on the road and get back to rocking and rolling, man. Rocking and rolling.